You found a large collection of art, including work by some very well-known modern artists, including Peter Blake, Robin Denny, and Bernard Cohen. This sounds like one of those World War II Nazi art theft discoveries.
Well, funny enough, the art's been hidden away in the basement of this Georgian manor house that was used as an army HQ in World War II. Not by the Germans, though. My dad, Barry Daniels, and Bernard Cohen moved into Marden Hill in May 1958, on the day I was born, actually. It's this very run-down former stately home in Hertfordshire. Dad and Bernard had studied together at the Slade with Bernard's brother Harold, Michael Andrews, Ewan Uglow, and Philip Sutton, all taught by the great William Coldstream. Obviously, I don't remember too much about those early days there, but the old photographs show these huge canvases filling every inch of the unfurnished drawing rooms and ballrooms. I think they were in a sort of artist's paradise at the time. There's no heating, bugger all to eat. This was luxury for them, just to have space to paint and store their work, really. Before Marden Hill, it was absolute chaos, living and painting in bedsits and lock-ups all around London. My dad told me about a time when he talked to my grandparents into looking after a very large and scary-looking painting for Michael Andrews. It ran the whole height and length of the living room in their very prim and proper bungalow in Bexhill-on-Sea, and stayed there, scaring my bewildered grandparents and any visitors there for months on end. Any port in a storm, I guess.
But it must have been a bit strange for them living in the middle of the countryside. After all, this was pre-hippie commune days.
True, Marden Hill was only an hour's drive from London, though, so it's close enough for the other artists to come down and paint, drink, argue, and for Bernard and Barry to sort of still be part of the London art scene. I'm told that when my parents went up to London, their first stop was always the Colony Room in Soho. They'd stick me in the Moses basket between Francis Bacon and Lucian Freud's bastards, my first babysitters. The logic was that those two old soaks weren't ever going to leave the bar, so I wouldn't be left on my own. I think Marden Hill became a bit like the Colony Room's country retreat. There was an endless stream of drunken playwrights, poets, musicians all coming down. A really weird mix too, people you'd never imagine being in the same room. Like Sylvia Plath and Mick Jagger, imagine that conversation.
So a country retreat for the British modern artists of the day. How did Danad Design fit into this?
While this group of painters were at the core of the abstract expressionist movement in the mid to late 50s, there really was change in the air. And pretty soon after moving to Marden Hill, my dad started Danad Design with Tom Adams. Tom was another artist living there, probably best known for all those wonderful Agatha Christie covers. Bernard Cohen mucked in, and then they enlisted Peter Blake's help, and Robin Denny and Edward Wright. That's three artists from the Slade and three from the Royal College of Art. And that itself is a lovely art history moment, because those two colleges haven't collaborated before or since, to the best of my knowledge. I guess it was just the spirit of the time. But Danad was a very big, bold statement. It was the first time fine art, difficult art, was taken off walls and given a new platform on furniture. And that was very good timing. It was the beginning of pop art, and they wanted to break the rules and challenge the status quo, and bang, Formica comes along. So now they can create a beautiful piece of art that people could spill beer on, stand on, eat their dinner on, and would remain unblemished. I guess it was about making art less exclusive and self-important, really. I don't know how my dad knew Denny and Wright, actually. Probably through shared exhibitions, but he and Peter Blake knew each other from their days at Gravesend School of Art in 1949. I do remember my dad telling me about a Victorian screen covered in cut-out images that he and Blake were both a little obsessed by in the Gravesend days. I've still got it somewhere, actually. We've all seen how that screen has informed most of Blake's work. My dad's journey, sadly, was a less artistic or a financially rewarding one. He just made a cut-out collage of women's underwear ads on our toilet door. I've still got that too. Danad caused us a huge stir. Though hailed as design visionaries, the pieces were sold exclusively through Heels, Liberties and Harrods. But Danad folded in 1962 because while they were very good artists with a highly desirable product, they were, crap businessmen.
So what now?
We'll see. It's all coming out of the basement now and seeing daylight for the first time in over 50 years. It feels a little like breaking the seal on Tutankhamun's tomb, really. This may not be the greatest collection of art, well, time will tell, but it's a perfectly preserved time capsule that dates back to one of the UK's most exciting creative periods.